Mandalorian Chapter 6 is out. 2 episodes left. That's disappointing.
I know, just 2.
Kind of a bummer since it's already starting to hit its stride, too.
Yeah, it is picking up. I don't know when Season 2 of Mandalorian will be out, but I think it won't be that far of a wait.
No, I don't think so either.
I think it's going to be one of those, like, you know, like reality show, or even just any show. Like, they sometimes have, like, 2 short seasons in 1 year. I think we're probably going to get it, I'd imagine, like, summerish?
Like 2020, you think?
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, I would say.
Oh, I mean, they're already filming.
Yeah,
I know that. Yeah.
Yeah. So we'll. All
right,
okay,
fucking cool.
Take your time.
We'll
do it right.
The road.
Do it right.
It's not over yet. It's not over yet. We still have 2 big episodes left. Yeah. But this episode, pretty fucking crazy. Off the top, a lot of people saying this is their favorite Mandalorian episode yet.
I think it's up there for me. Obviously, episode 3 is really awesome when he goes back for Baby O. And all the bounty hunters save him at the end. Episode 4 was cool with the AT-ST. Mm-hmm. This might be my favorite though.
It's pretty damn good.
I think it's my favorite,
this
too.
This one's,
but mostly,
like, dense.
It's good. I think,
like, we had a lot in this episode.
A lot of stuff happened. And also, it's a heist.
Episode.
Heists are cool.
Yes.
No matter what, a heist is always going to be cool.
Yeah.
It's a Western sci-fi heist.
Mm-hmm.
This actually feels like, it's not, I don't like calling Star Wars sci-fi, but, like, it's in that same vein.
Yeah,
but I'm going to call it a sci-fi Western heist.
That's exactly what they're going for. It reminded me a little bit of, you know, the Solo train heist. I know you guys don't love Solo, but the train heist scene I still think was very cool.
Definitely. I love the train heist scene.
Easter eggs of this episode. There's a lot. A lot of cool shit.
Yeah.
We're going to start off. We usually end with cameos. We got to start with cameos because
there's so many.
Every person in this episode is probably recognizable from something. Off the top, Bill Burr episode.
Yeah. This was...
Billy Blast is he plays Mayfeld.
Mayfeld.
Yeah,
is it Mayfeld?
Mayfeld. Okay. Yeah, Mayfeld. He is the leader of this group of bounty hunters. We'll get into the story, but they're working for, like, I think you and I talked about it. You said they're almost like an unsolicited secret bounty guild.
Yeah, like unregulated or something.
Yeah.
I don't know. They're bounty guild, but they're doing it on the side.
On the down low, not part of the guild.
Well, they're going after the New Republic. They're going after the prisoners. So they're really, like, these are shitty people. Bounty hunters, I'm not saying they're great people. Bounty hunters, for the most part, typically... had gone after, it seemed more, again, regulated.
They work within the system, the actual system of the New Republic, and obviously they're not at odds with the New Republic, but these guys are.
Yeah.
He does say some things that we'll get to in a minute, some amazing of the best quotes ever from any Star Wars thing. We'll get to
and
that.
And so perfect for Bill Burr. Himself.
Incredible. Great delivery.
The fact that he delivered, the jokes, it was...
Also, I'm glad we got as much of him as we did, because we were, like, looking forward to this every week, like, when are we going to get Bill Burr, when are we going to get Bill Burr, and it lived up to it.
Absolutely lived up to it.
It does. Mark Boone Jr. Plays the kind of leader of this unsolicited guild. Ranzer Malak is his name. Very similar to Rami Malek now that I'm reading it, actually. Sons of Anarchy, Memento. He's in Batman Begins. I thought he was in Dark Knight as well, but he's definitely in Batman Begins as, like, the very corrupt cop. That might be where most people recognize
him. He always plays a corrupt cop in everything he does. If you've ever seen Too Fast, Too Furious, a rat eats out his stomach. It's really gross.
Huh.
Really nasty.
Never seen that.
He basically plays a shitty, crooked guy in this, too.
So
he plays the character. Natalia Tena plays, I think, Sean. It's spelled X-I apostrophe A-N. Yeah, she's Twi'lek character,
Shion.
And we'll talk about that species. She was in, most notably, Harry Potter
Tonks.
And Fedora, right?
Mm-hmm.
Married to Lupin?
Right? She gets married to Lupin, yeah.
I
believe.
Robbie, not Harry Potter.
No, not to spoil Harry Potter, Big Dead, I believe.
Yeah, she's Big Dead.
Big Dead.
I mean, well, at this point, spoiler alert for Harry
Big
Potter.
Dead.
Yeah, she's dead in Harry Potter. She plays that character. That's where you'd probably most recognize her. We threw it up on screen. Clancy Brown.
My man. I love Clancy Brown.
Plays Berg, the muscle of the group. Voices Mr. Krabs. Did you know that?
No.
You didn't know that? Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, voices Mr. Krabs.
Savage
Bad
Press
Boys.
In Clone Wars.
Yeah, he's in Clone Wars. Thor Ragnarok plays Surtur, the
big devil guy
big
in
devil.
The beginning.
Shawshank Redemption, Highland. I mean, just
Starship Troopers.
It's Clancy Brown.
Mr.
All-time
Krabs.
Voice.
Unreal.
Yeah.
Yep.
But that,
unreal.
That's actually the one I forget about the most for some reason because there's so many other things that I know him for. I'm like, oh, that's right.
He's a guy, when you hear his voice, you immediately like, oh, that's him. And like, he is, like, that's for me. Like, I didn't recognize him by face, even though I've seen him in a bunch of stuff. Obviously, Starship Troopers, Highlander, all incredible. But like, his voice to me is so instantly identifiable. I was like, that's Clancy Brown right there.
Unreal.
Pretty awesome. Ismael Cruz Cordova, not a name that I think many people recognize, but a very funny little Easter egg here. He was on Sesame Street. His character's name was Armando, but they called him Mondo.
That's
almost like
funny.
Mando.
That's kind of funny.
Like,
and
really,
who was this in the episode?
He was the
male
Quinn,
Twi'lek.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So again, that's I would imagine not on purpose, but kind of like a funny coincidence that his character's name, Mondo in Sesame Street, is in Mandalorian. Matt Lanter. Matt Lanter. He plays Davin is the character's name. He is a New Republic soldier. Looks like a regular...
he's like the warden of the ship.
Rebel soldier. He was like running the prisoner ship. He voiced
just one of them too on the ship. We'll get to it. Yeah.
Imagine living on that ship with just... I mean, I guess at that point in the galaxy...
He's got all the robots with him, I guess.
Robots are friends, but even then. He voices Anakin Skywalker in the Clone Wars and the Rebel series. And
great
I guess
voice
he'll
actor.
Be back because they're bringing back Clone Wars, which I do forget about. Like, obviously this going away will be sad, but we're going to get new Clone Wars soon, and that's going to be a great game.
I always
think
Sam Witwer does Anakin's voice. I don't know why.
Because
I always
assume Sam Witwer does, like, every voice at this point.
Yeah.
So cool connection there.
Yeah, and Lanter always thought kind of looked almost like Anakin Skywalker a little bit. Like, if they could have recast, I'm like, shit, get Lanter.
You see, like, the side-by-side pictures of the animated Anakin and him, definitely.
Very
like,
similar,
He plays a great Anakin.
Great Anakin.
In the animated series.
Much more well-rounded than the Hayden Christensen one. No offense.
Writing is another thing.
Yeah, writing is obviously not his fault.
Richard Ayade. I don't know how to say his name, but I recognize him. A GIF is what I think most people know him from. From the show. It's a BBC show. I think you can either call it IT Department or the... IT Crowd or IT Crowd. It's obviously a play on words. You'll recognize him from that. He's obviously not recognizable in this because he voices a fucking robot, but he does voice the robot.
See in Neighborhood Watch,
in
too.
This one,
I think. The Ben Stiller one?
I think you might be right.
Yeah.
Is his guy one of these guys? Or does he just like... He's a robot version of that guy.
That's an alien.
No, I know, but his guy looked like this guy if he was a robot.
That's Forlom, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes.
No, he looks like a different robot.
Protocol
droid. We'll get into the robot, though. I think it might be a new robot, but it's similar to one that you brought up to me pre-show, so we'll talk about his connection. But no, it's a bounty hunter.
There was a familiar...
I didn't know you were a bounty hunter shirt.
Yeah, I'm wearing my bounty hunter shirt. I got a celebration this year. Not bad.
I wish I got that
It's a pretty good shirt.
Yeah,
it's a pretty good shirt.
Not a bad shirt.
Good
shirt for today.
And then we have three cameos at the end in the X-Wing. Three directors from this series. We have Dave Filoni plays a character, Trapper Wolf.
Cool name.
That's his Republic/Rebel pilot name. Rick Famuyiwa, who directed this episode. Mm-hmm. He directed a previous episode before that.
Yeah,
I think
which one?
Second episode he did.
Two?
He plays Jib Dodger. Which that sounds like a Star Wars name I would have
cool
made
name.
Up as a
That's
kid.
That's the best made up one.
Like,
perfect.
I bet he made that name. I bet all of them made these names up
they
as
They probably
kids.
Did, yeah.
And then Deborah Chow, who directed the third episode.
And the next episode,
the seventh, played an X-Wing pilot, Sash Ketter. So that was neat. And so I knew that was them at first, but the one that really stuck out was Filoni. You're like, oh shit, Dave Filoni.
Yeah.
The joy of Filoni. I don't think he's been in live action Star Wars as a cameo.
No, only voices and shit.
The joy for him to be live action in a Star Wars
thing. He's got to be so happy.
He's got to be so pumped. And people are so happy for him right now.
And the way they shot, like, the what do they call it? Like, the cockpit?
Yeah.
So original
old
trilogy.
Old school Star Wars
like,
right
it's
there.
It's so, like, the all the lighting, the darkness inside. Like, it was so old school.
Mm-hmm. Love that.
Bill Burr's character, Mayfeld, says three things that are very deep cut stuff. Well, I don't want to call them deep. No, they're kind of like...
They're very meta.
They're very meta Star Wars reference. Yeah. That's the best way to put it. The first one, he's a former Imperial sharpshooter.
Mm-hmm.
And Mandalorian kind of makes fun of him. He's like, that's not saying much. And Bill Burr turns around. I'm just calling him Bill Burr. I'm not calling him Mayfeld.
Yeah.
Let's establish that now.
Mm-hmm.
He says, I wasn't a stormtrooper, wise ass. Yes.
Wise ass, perfect Bill Burr word.
First of all,
way.
Have they ever said ass in Star Wars before?
No,
I don't think so.
Hell is the worst word said, is when I'll see you in hell, Han Solo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So he says ass, but he jokes, I wasn't a stormtrooper, wise ass, which in Star Wars canon, they've noted that stormtroopers did have bad aim
because they
were just normal people after like the trained clones. But just to acknowledge, like, yeah, okay, I know what you're saying. No, I wasn't a shitty stormtrooper.
So amazing.
Anything.
The way he delivered the line, so Bill Burr. I wasn't a stormtrooper, wise ass.
And then he references the casino planet, Canto Bite, which was in The Last Jedi.
Yeah.
He says that his ship, the Razor Crest, looks like a slot machine from Canto Bite, which that's kind of the first newish Star Wars references we get. And only the second time we've ever really heard about that planet, which we saw very briefly in Last Jedi.
Yeah, I think that's the first time we've heard any reference outside of like Last Jedi stuff to The Last Jedi, which is actually kind of cool.
So we get a swear word, an old dirty word, Bill Burr on brand. We get some gambling. That's on brand for Bill Burr right there, right? And then the next thing is he references Gungans.
Yes.
Jar Jar Binks species.
Shitting on Gungans.
He asks Mando why he won't take off his helmet. He goes, maybe he's a Gungan, which I went, out loud. I was like, oh my God. Which is the first time we've heard a live action reference of Gungans and Jar Jar species, obviously,
so
since
funny.
The prequels. And he says, And then he just, this is the most meta thing of it all. He says, is that why Yusa don't want to take off your helmet?
He does a little impression.
He does a Jar Jar impression, which, knowing Bill Burr, not a Star Wars fan. Like, no. He said it before. He said it on, there's a Conan interview where he's like, I missed the boat. I didn't see it that summer. I never got it. And he's in it, and he's the one, the first person to ever really make fun of Jar Jar.
Make fun of Gungans.
It's
Gungans
so perfect. Like, that thing. Role had to be written for Bill Burr specifically.
Yes.
Because everything he said was just so perfect.
It was wonderful.
3PO in the Clone Wars kind of makes fun of Jar Jar.
Yeah. Not like in to that 3PO. Same extent, though. Yeah. Like, making a stereotype accent of another species. Yeah.
In a 3PO. Only a way 3PO can make fun of him. So Bill Burr gets the first chance to really...
Amazing.
Shit on
the first
Gungans.
One is my favorite still, though, when he just turned around and said, I wasn't a stormtrooper, wise ass. I was just oh my God, Bill Burr is in Star Wars right now.
Wise ass, way better insult than like Nerf Herder or whatever.
Yeah,
Bantha Fodder. Like, yeah, come on.
I wonder if they wrote like Nerf Herder.
Yeah, he's like, I'm not saying that.
I'm going to call him a wise ass. We see a species. So Clancy Brown's character, Berg, is a Devorian. Mm-hmm. Devoronian,
yeah.
There we go. I'm bad with pronunciations. That's the devil species, which you'll most recognize from the cantina.
Yeah.
In A New Hope.
1 second shot frame.
He's like sitting there, and he kind of like looks around. He's like smiling. Probably had a good drink or something.
Yeah, he's part of that Mark Hamill thing when he's talking about it being disappointing. Yes. He's like, there was a real devil there. He's like, someone is just dressed as the devil.
Yeah, it just was. Just a devil. So we see that species, which we've seen before in Rebels. Sicatro Visago.
Yeah, Visago.
Visago, yeah.
Broken horn.
Sicatro Visago.
On Lothal, he's a crime lord. He kind of bullies them, tries to take their weapons
and accent.
Yeah, so we've seen that species before. We see a new one here, a very big one. He's a big character. We see Twi'lek. That's a species we've seen in Star Wars for years. I think the first famous one really is the one that falls down into the Rancor pit in Jabba's palace.
Yep.
She's a dancer.
No.
She's been referenced before. I think she was referenced in Rogue One, like that same one. Which, again, Rogue One just threw every fucking reference they could possibly throw at you. I like Rogue One, but still. Bib Fortuna is a Twi'lek.
Yep, the creepy, slimy, dick-looking king.
He's still the creepiest character in all of Star Wars.
Why was he so wet
his
all
teeth
the time?
And his skin
was just moist.
We've seen tons of them. Isla Secura, who was a Jedi, she gets gunned down.
Murdered on a fuchsia, right? No.
Pretty cool planet, flowery planet.
That we've never been back to.
Almost Pandora-esque.
You play it in Battlefront. You play it in the video game.
She gets the worst fight out of all the Jedi that get killed in Order 66 in the movie, where she just like turns and boop, just mowed down. Just like, at least Ki-Adi Mundi got to block one laser.
Yeah.
So we've seen this character before, now back with more of a main character. Speaking role, probably the biggest speaking role that any... like the species has had in live action.
Definitely.
So the droid.
In live action,
for sure. Live action, because obviously in
Rebels,
in Rebel, we've seen it. An RA-7 droid looks very similar to this droid Zero, but I don't know if it's the same one, because this droid is Q90.
Yeah.
So sometimes that number and letter will indicate the type, but it's a very similar protocol droid to ones we've seen in Jabba's Palace, we've seen in Sandcrawler.
3B.
They're like bugs. They look like Forlorn, kind of.
Yeah. That's what
they inspired. Maybe they're modeled off that, and it was protocol droid, so I don't know how you can modify a protocol droid into a fighting droid. But
K2SO was, some kind of imperial.
He was an imperial intelligence
droid. Somehow.
This is a very human droid too.
If you play Jedi Fallen Order, the imperial intelligence droids, like what was his name again? Sorry, K2SO, right? You fight them, and they are very hard to beat.
Oh shit! I'm only like one level in still.
Very hard to beat.
She was a pretty good droid, even though not my very horny droid too.
Yes,
that was Solo was a horny movie. Mando's kind of horny too, just very clearly. I think they imply it.
Mando definitely be fucking.
Yeah, yeah, they don't like to mention it, but there was a lot of love implied because he has a history with the Twi'lek character.
I like that Shion line where where she says, "What was it? Like a lady never tells if she saw him without his helmet on."
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's a good line.
MSE-6 droids, repair maintenance droids, also known as mouse droids. Mm-hmm. Kind of.
The noise. The noise made me so happy when I heard it.
It's the noise. Roamed around. Clancy Brown shot it, which. Always Chewie roared at it, shooting it. Just leave
it
alone.
Yeah, leave it alone.
Just
what can
it
do to you? I saw a mouse today. Here, leave it alone.
You did. You saw a mouse. Yeah. How about that?
What can it possibly do to you?
They kind of reacted to it like it was like a mouse. Like they were kind of like grossed out by it, which I thought was like kind of weird.
Like what the fuck is that? It was probably Bill Burr's real reaction. Like what is this?
Yeah.
What the fuck is this? X-wings, like we mentioned, just straight up X-wings. Very
awesome.
Cool. Always cool to see.
Always
S foils
cool.
and attack
just
formation.
The coolest fucking ships out there.
Always cool to see X-wings, no matter what. The space station that they were on, it did have it wasn't similar at all in terms of like size. but it had the same kind of structure as Cloud City, if you notice, where it has that elongated bottom with like a
like small, a sorry piece,
so like a ball thing. Yeah, exactly, upside down. I guess that ball or whatever makes it help float or something, keep it stabilized. But the fighter that they were pulling out, the fighter jet that they had in that was like rising from beneath, because at the end of the episode,
the gunship
they were going to have the gunship try and go blow up Mandalorian. It had a lot of similar vibes, and I wrote down on here Jedi fighter, but it just clicked in my head. It looked a lot like General Grievous's ship.
Yeah, it did a little bit.
Huh.
It had like things on the side.
The two big things on the
like
side.
Like a big-ass Corvette.
I couldn't get a good look at it, but it looked a lot like General Grievous's ship.
I don't hate that.
So there's your Easter egg.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm just going to call it that.
Fuck it.
I think it had a lot of guns.
We're going to go out ahead, and we're going to... It did, yeah.
There's like 500 guns sticking out of it.
And then one of my favorite ones, we haven't seen one of these helmets. We saw in Rogue One a little bit. We saw it in A New Hope as the Rebel Fleet Trooper helmet.
Bilbo
calls him Egghead. Stupid-ass helmets.
The stupidest helmets of all time. Yeah. I don't know why they would ever wear those.
Just so large and just
everyone
not really
in Star
much.
Wars, I was thinking about this because the second sister from First Order has the same thing. They have like a visor over there, the back of their head.
Yeah. Why do you need so much protection
why
there?
Why is that such a Star Wars
imagine
thing?
Like trying to lean back. Like it would, you
no,
know
I wear a backwards hat every day. It sucks when I go to the movies or something like that.
When you lean back in a recliner, you got to take the hat off. It's not practical. Those are the Easter eggs. Let's get into the episode. It starts off Mando clear looking for work. Part of what I like
side quest city.
Yep. Exactly. It is just side quest. It's a very old school serial type vibe, not this big overarching drama.
Although I do want more of that as we continue.
I think as we
more
wrap
jobs?
We'll get that.
Huh?
Like more jobs?
No. More overarching narrative.
Okay.
For the entire season.
Yeah, which I think we will kind of come to a head on that. But I was curious. I was like looking up on Twitter what people thought, and someone who just started it said, is Mandalorian supposed to be like this big HBO drama? Like, why are people who don't like the structure disappointed? Because it was never teased. It was supposed to be, again, the type of thing that George Lucas based Star Wars off of.
Yeah.
And I think they captured it perfectly. It may not be for everyone. That's very fair. But if that's what they were going for, they nailed it.
Definitely.
Exactly what we're getting. So he's got a history with this team, with Mark Boone Jr.'s character, Ranzar Malik. He's trying to get some work. He even references, like, I heard you're kind of out with the guild. Things aren't going too well with them.
Word's getting around.
No questions asked.
Word is getting around.
That was very necessary.
Word is getting around. So he accepts this job pretty reluctantly.
Yeah.
And then he finds out that they're about to go infiltrate a New Republic prisoner ship, which I actually thought when I saw the hologram, it was going to be like a troop transport, which has been in Rebels, which is like the old toy from Kenner where they had a troop transport. Which
oh,
like,
I know what you're talking
not
about,
not like a real thing at the time, but they just had it to put your toys in it. I thought it was going to be that. That's not what we got. We just got a regular prison.
I would have loved to see them pitching the hologram to Bill Burr, like how he acts out that scene. Like, all right, point to this. This is the hologram. Like, just like, the fuck am I doing here? I'm not a stormtrooper wise ass.
We haven't gotten many prisons in Star Wars. Like, just regular-ass prisons. We got the detention cell, detention block and all that. Death Star. We haven't seen many prisons. So they go after that. He meets
Rogue
up with the team.
Rogue One has a prison.
True, yep.
Yeah.
There's some history there, like we mentioned with the Twi'lek character. Maybe like a bit of a love interest.
Maybe
they
fucked.
They don't seem to like him.
Did you guys make this?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, they reference that on Baby Yoda. They do find Baby Yoda. So Mandalorian's pretty uneasy, as you can tell. Because they don't want to be with him. He doesn't want to be with them. He's being used for his ship, basically, but he needs the money. And the droid stumbles upon, a bit of a hint for later on in the episode, a message from Carl Weathers, Greef Karga. Looks like an older message. Someone has an audience question about that, so we'll get to like what that message was. Then he gets on the ship, and they board, and they go off to this Imperial prison to try to capture a prisoner, and that's when they stumble upon Baby Yoda. They're making fun of him for his helmet, and then accidentally the big character, Berg, tries to take his helmet off, and he hits the little switch, and the door opens and Baby Yoda's revealed. So now, not only are they on to him about just being kind of like in the doghouse with the guild, they know about Baby Yoda.
And they have the bounty in sight, and they know where it is.
I love Baby Yoda's little cupboard, too, in the Razor Crest. It reminds me of like that Harry Potter under the stairs.
He's got a little
stairs.
Bored of it, too. You can tell. He's like,
walk
around.
Yeah. He literally opened it up and left in the last episode.
Yeah. He's like, I want to get out of here.
But they know. And Bill Burr even drops him at one point because the droid's an idiot. The droid gave no countdown.
Yeah, what the
bad
fuck
droid.
Was that? Yeah.
And I actually thought for a second, I'm like,
this guy's like part of their crew and that's how he operates?
He says, I'm much more intelligent than you organics. And it's like, well, clearly not. He didn't even give him a countdown.
I mean, great pilot. Makes a great maneuver to dock on the ship without being detected. But I liked, again, just little subtle details in writing. I was Like, why no count them? That's dumb. And then the character actually mentions, says like, didn't even give us a warning.
Something we literally mentioned in the last recap is that Filoni is great at this, in which, like, you're like, wow, why didn't they do this? And then 2 seconds later, whatever that point is addressed.
There's
they
an awareness.
Great
lie, Yep. So again, they see Baby Yo. You had to have been just devastated to see Baby Yo fall.
He fakes it first. Like, Bill Burr's like, oh, I'm going to drop him. Like, all right, let's not. He is a baby. He
calls him a pet.
And then he fucking, like, dropped Baby Yo. You can't drop a baby. Can't I don't do care it. If he's 50. You can't drop a baby. I was hoping that Baby Yo would do the Luke Skywalker Last Jedi thing and catch himself at the last second, but he's just too young. He didn't realize.
I'm glad he didn't do that, though. That might have been, they might have abandoned the
mission. Oh, you know what? True, yeah.
Yeah, Baby Yo.
Been like,
smart.
What the fuck is that, Bill Burr?
So they go into this prison. And this is where it really starts to take off. Like, we haven't seen too much of this point in the episode. They're setting it all up. You're getting to know there's going to be a lot of tension between them. Mando doesn't like them at all. He's a great fighter. Bilber gives him shit like, I heard you're such a great fighter. So they're in the prison, and they're going to find the prison. They get captured, or they get caught, excuse me, by those droids. And this is where we see some of the best action you'll ever see in a Star Wars thing.
The only thing Mando hates more than those guys is droids.
Yeah.
Fucking hates
those
droids.
Hates droids.
And those droids.
I was surprised he was cool with Zero.
Yeah, right?
Barely
he didn't really. Yeah, true.
Even he's like, I don't think he said anything to Zero, but
he's like, do you trust him? He says, do you trust him to Ren? He's like, do you trust that guy? And like, he's like, no, I don't trust anybody.
Yeah.
That's what Ren says.
He kind of gave him it through the helmet, that look of like, oh,
these droids looked a lot like Chappie. Did you notice that? And they serve the same function.
They sort of did.
Police.
They did the same thing.
They were good fighters a little bit.
Little hand-to-hand combat. It looked cool.
So Mando goes one on six?
On eight. I like those odds.
Maybe more, yeah. And he just takes them down, uses the fire, uses his, like...
Grappling ring.
Get over here. Scorpion
rips
thing.
Him
rips
down.
The dude's head off.
Tears through one of their heads. Shoots a hole in one of the heads.
Which is so cool when you get the shot where it's like, you see him through the hole in his head. Yeah. Oh, so well done.
And again with this action, because then we see a little more action afterwards. We see Burke, he takes these big, like, floating droids and just fucking smashes them against each other.
Why do they insist on hand-to-hand combat with droids with lasers?
Like, yeah, I don't
know. He runs up with a knife and knifes a robot. Yeah. Like, use this when you're fighting the organics. Like, use anything else when you're fighting a robot.
And there was some robot blood early on. I mean, we got more robot blood later on, but there was some oil.
Like the oil, yeah.
We saw some action in something like Rogue One, right, in Solo, but it's always nice to see a lot of Star Wars action that has no lightsabers.
Yes.
Definitely,
yes.
Because, like, it's still cool.
You don't need
lightsabers to be cool. I mean, I prefer lightsabers. They're awesome.
Lightsabers are, but they are also game changers, right?
Totally.
And that's like Anakin and Obi-Wan in the prequels. Yeah. When they were up against battle droids, it's filler. It was basically filler because you knew they were going to cut them all down. So then they happen upon the control room. There's a Mexican standoff type scene.
Yep.
Classic Western type shit where they're flipping the
Reservoir Dogs almost.
Yep, big time. Exactly, yeah. And then the Twilight.
Insert office gif here.
Yes.
Twilight character Shira just fucking throws a knife right at that poor New Republic guy.
These knives, how do they work? Because she turned them on when she uses them later, too. They're like electric.
And we saw something like that when Favreau's heavy Mando got into the fight with Mandalorian.
They're like digitized,
Yes, they have some kind of like glitch about them. They're cool.
They're definitely
very Star Warsy.
Yeah.
He has a code. Mandalorian obviously has a way about how he goes things. He has morals. He doesn't want to kill the guy. He even says, like, I didn't think we were going to be killing anyone here.
Yep.
The bounty hunters don't give a shit.
But there's also
about
a tease in the back
that
he used to enjoy killing people.
Exactly.
He used to use people as target practice. That's
Azog 3 or whatever. They say, like, ask him what he did on Azog 3. And he's like, I didn't have a choice or something like that. But so, like, clearly there's a darker
past
than we know.
And then was like, oh, you enjoyed it.
We know you liked it.
Yeah, so he's a different guy now, but it doesn't matter because that guy gets knifed.
Yeah.
He's dead. He's done.
R.I.P. Anakin.
But as he did that, he was threatening to turn on a New Republic like tracker. Basically a tracking device that the Republic will be there with their X-Wings like that. Little hint for later on in the episode. They finally go over and they find the prisoner. And it happens to be actually one of the prisoners. I forgot to mention it's an Easter egg. One of the prisoners is the same species of the character Jon Favreau plays in Solo.
Yep.
Well, do we know the species name? It's like the.
Because he says it. Remember, like, Solo says it. He's like, you're clearly not a stormtrooper. You're whatever this, because you have your two arms hanging out of your back.
Yeah.
He's like, what are you talking about? I'm an Imperial stormtrooper.
He has, he's like,
it's
like
an R,
a monkey.
I forget what.
He has, like, this monkey look to him. We'll toss the comp on screen. So they get the prisoner out of there. It's the brother of Sean Quinn.
Quinn.
Clearly,
these Star Wars names are fucking.
I know they have a history. Mando left him at some point back when they used to be partners, and they shove Mando into a prison cell. They shoot a blaster, which is really cool. They shot a blaster and had
it
bounce.
Why did they not make armor out of whatever they line these prisons with?
Jeff, you got to figure out how to put those in this video. bing, 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 bing,
shooting a laser.
At all times, though. Maybe we'll release it as a special edition. Yeah. What the hell is going on?
Is it made out of Beskar, though? Because his Beskar, he deflects bullets like the fucking...
Like lasers just go bouncing
like
off.
Like anything. Like Dr. Manhattan. Yeah. He's got this Dr. Manhattan vibe to him, the way Mando like deflects lasers and blasts.
Yeah.
So he's in the prison. You know he's going to escape, but it's a matter of how he's going to escape. That's the big question.
I had no idea how. I was like, I don't know what's going to happen. I was thinking,
are we going to end this episode with him in the prison?
I thought so, too. I thought, okay, we're going to see him escape next time, and they're about to capture you.
Or some kind of Cara Dune. Oh, I was terrified.
Because during this moment, the droid also finally decodes Griff Karga's message and realizes that there is a bounty, and he looks behind him, and Baby Yo is up top in the cockpit kind of staring at him like,
hey, what's up?
What's up, dude? What are you doing? What's going on? So he goes after him. So this is all kind of going down as Mando finds a way to break out. He breaks out of the cell. He shoots one of his grappling hooks and pulls a droid, fucking rips his arm through.
Blood everywhere. Robot blood, but still blood.
Robot oil blood everywhere. He rips him through the door, and then he escapes. And this is where it becomes very, like, horror movie, like, Alien-esque.
Yes.
It had a lot
literally
of
aliens. Yeah.
Even Space Odyssey vibes.
To reference another thing we do, Watchmen, it was like when Rorschach's like, I'm not locked in here with you. You're locked in here with me.
Oh, very much so. You don't want to be in there with Mando.
A lot of you aren't going anywhere vibes.
Yes.
So they're trying to escape, and now Mando is on the prowl. We saw on our podcast Reddit, somebody said... A lot of xenomorph vibes from Mandalorian there. Again, Alien is the first thing that came to my mind.
The strobe was just so...
That was so cool.
The way it was shot
was slowly getting closer and closer. And then even not doing the... When he gets right there and he hits something from the back, like the turn.
Yep.
Oh, so good.
It's something that we haven't seen really in Star Wars. We haven't seen anything quite like that in Star Wars.
Like horror-ish. Not horror vibes, but like horror-ish. Like adjacent.
Yeah, exactly. So he kind of defeats every one of them one by one. Berg gets... I thought he died, I will say, because they all
the
end
first
up...
first time, yeah.
Spoiler alert within the spoilers. They all end up living because he just threw him in a cell because his code isn't just to be killing him. That's not who he is anymore.
I had a feeling he was doing that, and I'm so glad.
I did, but not at first because Berg, I thought he just sliced Berg in half.
I thought he got killed when the first door went down.
I did think he sliced Berg in half.
So I don't know how that worked. I don't know how he escaped that one.
Mando's secondary most preferred weapon
between the doors?
Maybe.
I don't really know how that worked, but what do you call it? I think Mando's second most preferred weapon after his blaster is doors.
He loves doors. Second time
he's incapacitated someone with a door.
But then the other characters, we don't see him kill the Sean, the Twilight character. Yeah. So that was kind of the hint for me. I know, Robbie, you said that as well. You were like, I kind of get the sense that maybe they're not dead.
Because he stopped the knife, yeah.
Because I'm like, look, we've seen a lot of kills. I feel like they're not just cutting these to be PG, right?
Yeah.
So... Then you see Bill Burr's
character. Especially with the first episode, how we even like heard the legs drop on the one. They're pushing the limits a little bit.
I was like, all right, a little weird they didn't show the death. And then we see it again with Bill Burr's character where he's kind of peering, like popping in and out of the darkness and the red strobe light. Yep. And then he's like, oh no, and the Bill Burr
turns and boop, dead.
Yeah, and so again, I was like, seems like he's dead, but they didn't show it. All right, we'll get back to that later, I feel like. And then one more takedown, you think he's going to eliminate the prisoner himself. Prisoner gives up.
Yeah.
He's like, you need your bounty. He goes, take me as prisoner. He puts his gun down. So they get into the Razor Crest and they fly away. They fly back to the space station. He gets his bounty. Old Mark Boone Jr. laughing away. I thought they were going to try to shoot Mando. Like I felt like an attack was imminent.
I definitely thought something was happening.
He says, no questions. Like, where's my crew? No questions. That's what you say. No questions asked. So as he flies away, we mentioned it again. We talked about Easter eggs. They have that gunship. That's going to go kill Mando. He's like, kill him.
Let's note, he gave him the money and then ordered to kill him. Doesn't seem like a very sound fiscal strategy, right? I'm going to blow you up in space after I gave you all my money.
Yeah, true.
But how would he leave otherwise?
Maybe
just kill him before.
Just kill him before somehow, but I don't know.
Maybe his mindset was like, there's no way if we try to get into a gunfight on our ship that we're getting out of it alive, so let's fucking give it to him and see what happens afterwards.
Just lose the money, who cares?
So many people in there, though. There were people working on ships. Yeah. Be like, everyone. The second he gets here, even Ki-Adi Mundi, the Jedi, he was amazing, but when there's 5,000 stormtroopers shooting at you, you're going to eventually die.
Yeah,
but the guy's an idiot, so it's
bad. He was clearly not too smart.
He's struggling to even have a job land without Mando, so he clearly needed some help, and he wasn't a very smart guy. But the big twist, Mando planted the Republic tracking device on the prisoner character, Quinn, and now the Republic is there. They shoot the gunship with the X-Wings. Very cool scene. Mando's crafty. He knows what he's doing. Because we saw earlier on when he was in the control room, he picked up the device, and it was a a look ahead to something. I actually forgot about it. Bad watching on my part. I forgot he even had it. But you were like, he's going to do something with that. And what he did, he ended up planting it on him.
Yep.
Great move. So
and then all of a sudden, all those X-Wings come out of hyperspace and he dodges them. By the way, they should have been like, hey, who's this guy leaving this? Yeah, we got to stop him too.
Yeah, yeah.
Get away.
Like,
oh, we don't
he
care.
Was just like, oh, sorry, sorry.
Our bad,
excuse
our bad.
Excuse me.
So, oop. Yep. It's the guy in the elevator move. By the way, we almost buried the lead here. When the robot Zero gets killed by Mando, Yoda thinks he could fucking force influence him.
So when he gets on the ship, Baby Yoda is still running away from Zero, the robot. Mm-hmm. He's peering around the corner, looking all cute and shit.
Looked like the Derek Rose meme, just him peeking around the corner.
I thought he was going to use the Force at that point.
So did
and
I.
Then he hides. He hides in his little cubby area. For some reason, Zero, an idiot. I mean, for being a smart robot, why would you want to kill him?
Mm-hmm. Like, I guess because the thing they said you could take him in alive or dead or something, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So he's getting ready to shoot him, and Baby Yoda lifts his hand, and I'm expecting the Force to smash the robot's head in.
Yeah, implode his head or push him or something, and then he's like, you could see he do the wave, and I'm like, oh, no. Yoda, no, he's not organic. You can't do that.
But then Mando just shoots the robot
right
in the head.
He looks at his hand like
it's
when fucking
reveal.
He looks like, it's like at the end of Saving Private Ryan where Tom Hanks is shooting the tank with the pistol, and he's like, huh?
Yeah.
When it blows up, it's like Yoda's just like, holy shit, I just blew him up like that.
He should tell him. He's like, oh, wow, great job, Baby Yo. You did it.
Yeah.
That wasn't me at all.
Yeah.
Give him a little confidence boost. And then that's kind of the end of the episode. As it ends, Baby Yo gets the little ball off the lever. Mando very clearly
loves that ball.
More and more attached to Baby Yoda.
He likes that motherfucker.
He loves him. And he says, too, and this is going to be our first audience question. He says, I told you that was a bad idea. So they're I don't know if he's actually talking to him or it's
got
more
a repertoire.
I talk to my dogs the same way.
Yeah,
right,
me too.
I mean.
Right? Be like, should I go in there, dog?
Yeah.
And you go in there and you get it's like, I told you that was a bad idea.
Yeah.
Like that same thing. Because user on Reddit, G2FX said, anyone notice that Mando can communicate with Baby Yoda? I think it's more like that, how you communicate with an animal like that.
Yeah. Unspoken bond.
Should we do this spot? I don't think so, right?
Yeah, no, I don't think so.
So no talking yet. Though, there was a weird feeling I had where I thought he might talk at that moment. I was like, oh, no.
Yeah. Yep. Like, don't say anything.
Wait a second. We tweeted out last week that Baby Yoda's voiced by comedian Paula Poundstone.
Yes. Noted this
It didn't catch on. Nobody believed us. At Rojo36 says, was the grief cargo message old or new? So
Carl
definitely. Weathers, that was definitely an older message.
Yep. That was the old one.
Trying to decode it. Wipe your messages on your ships.
Yeah, come on, man.
Yeah,
you gotta wipe your browser history. That's the number one rule.
Especially, so many people are getting on the Razor Crest at all times.
And you know people are looking for Baby Yo. They're looking for you. Delete.
I think the second that Rand said the robot was flying, I'd be like, hold on, I gotta wipe my browser history really quick.
Yeah.
Just gotta make sure.
Yeah, and he let the robot in there before. He didn't even enter the ship. He just let the robot waltz in and do his own thing. You gotta burn the books.
Yeah.
Shred the evidence. And then at MikeNero43 said, what do we think Baby Yoda would have done to the droid? I think the head would have crushed in.
Yeah.
That's what I was expecting. I was expecting the head to just crunch in.
I sort of thought, even when he got shot, that's what I thought he was going to do.
I sort of thought that it was going to be like in when The Force Awakens, when Kylo stops the laser bolt,
distracts.
I thought he was going to stop it and turn it.
I
or
could
something.
Still see him doing that.
It was such a sick
We haven't
by
seen
way.
The laser bolt stop since Force Awakens
so cool.
in live action, so I could see him doing that. No other real questions. It's a pretty straightforward episode.
Yeah.
No big tease. The last episode, and we'll look ahead to episode 7, directed by Deborah Chow, episode 8, directed by Taika Waititi. Very pumped for that. The vibe on that one is going to be.
Ooh,
I feel like off the charts, especially as a season finale.
I hope that one's longer. I hope we get a good 60 minutes.
I think
minutes
the next
something.
Two will be longer. My question is, when do you think we're going to get addressed who that person was at the end of the last episode? Because we didn't get any reference
next week,
to that whatsoever.
I say.
So next week's episode got teased as an old rival extends an invitation for the Mandalorian to make peace.
It's got
to
be Grief Karga.
So it's Grief Karga. It's either Grief Karga, but it says an old rival. He's a new rival, if anything, right? Grief Karga.
Because they are
friends. I think either that could be whoever this mystery character is, quote unquote, we'll just say Boba Fett at this point. We don't really know. Or maybe not Grief Karga, but Moff Gideon. Yeah, Moff Gideon. Maybe it's him. Maybe he's the old rival.
We have to see the big bad at some point because it's been teased in the trailer. So I do think Giancarlo Esposito's character does come in next episode.
Yeah.
We have to at this point.
Yeah.
Yep.
Unless he's the big finale thing.
I imagine Baby Yo's storyline picks up back to the importance of this character in the next episode. I think something will happen with him, with Mando early on in the next episode that makes him address that as a problem as opposed to him just trying to being on the run and getting money for food and living.
I think if you're going to introduce someone like a Grand Moff, I think that's going to be a two-episode thing. So I feel like that's going to have sort of like an introduction in this next episode and then continuation into episode 8. And I don't know how that's going to work exactly, but I do think that he's probably going to be the big bad for this next episode.
He will be back on that first planet as well. Yep. We've seen some trailer stuff, him beating up stormtroopers. We've seen the death troopers.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So I don't know what to expect, but I know we're going to kind of ramp up in terms of scope, right? We're on these side quests, and I think something's going to kind of spark the next movement that will require him to address the Baby Yoda problem, which there's a Baby Yoda. He's got a Baby Yoda problem right
Here's
now.
Here's a question for the two of you. Do you think we have seen the last of Bill Burr's crew this season?
Oh, I didn't even mention
this
that.
This season,
there
probably, yeah.
Yeah.
This season, yes. Season.
I think this season we probably have, especially because Bill – actually, yeah, we definitely have because Bill Burr, unless he was lying, said we're only in one episode. Mm-hmm. But I cannot wait to see the next season already.
Yes, me too.
Sure even in like – Great other crew. Star Wars properties. You could use them in a different show if you wanted mm-hmm. to.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know how timeline-wise.
For sure a crew, and I bet Mando's crew goes up against him at some point. Because
That would be awesome. Yeah.
I didn't mention that they are alive. Bill Burr, all those characters are
alive. It's a great
crew. He adheres
except for Zero. Zero big dead.
Zero stinks. Yeah. That's a bad... You can get a new droid. Get a new fucking protocol droid. And he wasn't even that courteous. Mm-hmm. He didn't warn them about doing these crazy like aerial dives to dock on a ship. It's a cool crew to see pop up at some other point. I'm glad he kept them alive. And again, it fits with the character too. It wasn't just some ham-fisted like oh, he... Like, I actually thought at one point, like, maybe he shoots him and Bill Burr wakes up or something. Mm-hmm. No, it was him adhering to his morals and how he goes about life.
Yeah, I think that basically everyone we've seen Mandalorian meet now since, like, episode 2 has betrayed him nonstop. Yeah. Everyone he ever talks to betrays
him. Except Cara Dune.
That's basically it, but she was a new introduction, basically, right? So I think he can't really depend on anyone except the Mandalorians, really, at this point. So I think that's going to have to eventually be the people he kind of settles with.
Pretty cool episode, though.
Dope episode.
Again, great music, by the way. They remixed the music with the garage beats on it. So sick.
Every time one of the characters dropped down from the ship into the prisoner thing, they had like their own little theme play. It was pretty neat.
It's so awesome.
Ludwig's been done Ludwig Göransson, right?
Göransson.
Again, he's done some great stuff, including most recently, like in terms of mainstream stuff, Creed.
Creed is so good.
But the sound of this and the Mando thing has been stuck in my head for weeks now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's been fantastic.
So good.
Love this show.
Also, Careless Whisper from Watchmen, which we will have the...
That's right.
Is the final episode.
Yeah.
Final
series
episode of Watchmen.
Finale. Although they keep saying season finale on HBO. I know Lindelof is like, it's only one. HBO definitely wants them
to come
back
for
two.
For sure.
So another one of these will be next Wednesday, the 17th. The 17th of December. Make sure if you're on YouTube, hit the like button, hit subscribe, hit the bell icon to be reminded when these come out. We try to get them out as quick as we can. So next week, we're a packed week on here. Monday, we have Watchmen season finale. We're going to have a lot to unpack.
Yep.
It's going to be our longest one yet. There's going to be a lot to unpack. Unless he may just blurt it all out there. We just were like, okay, that's what happened.
Yeah.
And then Wednesday, Mandalorian airs early next week because Star Wars Rise of Skywalker comes out. We're going to do another one of these for the Rise of Skywalker. So I'll have this for Mandalorian next week on the 17th. And then the 18th at about 8 p.m. Eastern, so right when the first showings for Star Wars Rise of Skywalker are happening, we will be releasing a breakdown video of the movie, the end of the Skywalker saga. So look forward to that.
So close.
Yeah.
Getting there.
Unreal.
Big Star
right there.
Week.
Unreal.
For Robbie Kenjek, I'm Jeff Lowe. Thanks for watching. Talk to you next time.